Lord, I want to thank you in the morning, in the evening, and all day and night. I want to thank you for the great things you've done for the whole of my life. Lord, I want to thank you in the morning, in the evening, and all day and night. I want to thank you for the great things you've done for the whole of my life. I want to thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ, my Savior, whose blood was shed on the cross to wash away my sins. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. You give me joy and peace and happiness today and tomorrow. Whatever do, bad time or good time, you are always with me. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ, my Savior, whose blood was shed on the cross to wash away my sins. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. When the wind blows strongly by the sea, you stretch your hands to lead, and you give me hope and courage to keep on and on sailing. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ, my Savior, whose blood was shed on the cross to wash away my sins. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord.
Thank you. sister, you're most welcome. We are talking about the revival. And my elder here says revival from spiritual death. Because I was asking the class whether what revival is from what. Because today we're going to talk throughout about revival. So we are saved by God. Next time, all of us, we should make it a priority. We should go through our quarter. I think I'll be the first to say that I've read the quarter despite of my busy schedule. So make it a day.
A number of texts again have been given in this reading. We'll be moving on quickly for lack of time. We always get short of time. But key things that come out from Sunday's reading. One, the word gives us comfort. It gives us hope. The word gives us understanding. The word is the truth. The word delivers us. It gives us deliverance. That's deliverance from sin.
David found courage and strength in God's word. It gives us the situations where David really believed in God's word. When he was found with sin, after the sin with Bathsheba, he thought to go to God's word and he found courage and hope for the future. When he was really disturbed in life, due to the gap that was created as a result of sin, he found courage in God's word. So the word of God really delivers us in all our circumstances that we found in.
How is the Bible different from other inspirational books? Because there are also other spiritual books that we read. So what distinguishes the Bible from other spiritual books? Let's say, for example, Ellen G. White books, other spiritual books we read. That makes it distinctive and different.
I think the Bible encompasses it like an umbrella. It covers all the aspects of whatever the inspirational books have talked about. You find that each book, maybe this has talked about prophecy, health, and other things, but all that can be found in one book, and that's called the Bible.
You find the Bible is the written word of God. There is the written word of God, which is the Bible, and there is the spoken word of God. The spoken word of God, we see it in the time of creation, and there is power in both. In the spoken word of God, we see there was power for creation, and everything came into form and being. Even with the Bible is the written word of God, and in it there are promises and there is power also. It's different from the other books. Because once you put all your trust and faith in God, you'll be able to receive, and those promises will be upon your life, and they'll come true as well.
In the book, like this book, it's like they were all written by different authors, right? But they all say the same thing. It's like someone was sitting in, like, there was this passage that I was reading. It's like someone was building a picture, an image, just the building, but it was all built by different architects, and they were just said, someone was saying to them, go put this in this place, in this building. And it's different because the authors were inspired by the Holy Spirit. And normal inspiration books, the authors are inspired by the Holy Spirit most of the time. Like what has happened in their life sometimes, so just how I see it differently.
So both to our regular members and also to those that are visiting with us today, a very special welcome. Your guest day today. Now, I have a very long list of our visitors for today, and we are blessed and happy for that.
Tell
Yesu natamiko kuboko alefwa ya wise we walubile wela alikutemwa iwe Yesu natamiko kuboko alefwa ya wise we walubile wela alikutemwa iwe
Amen. I will ask them to greet you all.
Good morning, church.
Amen.
Good morning, my friends.
Amen.
My name is Kauda Ansari.
Good morning, church.
Amen.
Good morning, my friends.
Amen.
Our story is about a man whose life was completely changed by the healing power of Jesus. His legs didn't work at all. He was paralyzed. So his friends picked him up from his mat. They carried him to a house where Jesus was preaching. It was too crowded, so they didn't know how to get to Jesus with the man. So his friends had a very unusual idea. They took him up on top of the house and made them go through the roof and lowered him in front of Jesus. Jesus said, "Son, your sins are forgiven. Get up, take up your bed, and walk home." What do we learn from this story? We learn that this man had some great friends. God wants us to be great friends to others, especially the needy. Help the needy as much as you can. This pleases God. Amen.
Oh, the Holy Spirit. subject is as indicated was previously on the screen. Is your water bitter? So that's chapter 15. Verses 22 through 27. Bible says, so Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore, the name of it was called Marah. 24, and the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? And he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast into the water were made sweet. And there he made for them a statute and an ordinance. And there he proved them. Now, since the following verses, and said, thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord your God. And you see, verse 27 has good news. Beloved, you and I, as we live on earth, we will have to drink some bitter waters at times. Bitter waters at home, bitter waters in school, bitter waters at church sometimes. But ours is to pray to God, to ask our Savior to sweeten the water. As we pray to him, God does not bless us according to what we can see around us, beloved. God blesses us according to his riches in glory. God provides for his children. I have seen God provide rock water out of the dry rock for me personally. I have seen the crippled walk. I'm not speaking from without. But I have prayed before my God. I have prayed with some people that have challenges, and God himself was able to come through. What is the situation today, beloved? Is your water bitter? Is the question that we live with you today. Is it too bitter for God to turn into sweet water that you can drink? For water is life. Oh, beloved, I want to declare before you today, there is sweet anointing in this sunshine.
Father in heaven, it is our honest and humble prayer for the sake of this life you have given to us as an opportunity to exist in this creation. We bring glory, honor, and praises to your name, and Christ, our high priest, shall live the most holy. It is our prayer because we agree with your word, which says, all things are possible to them that believe. We ask all this because you have created us that we may all bear the glory of your character in us, which is your image, which can be regenerated and put back by your spirit. Bless us all with your peace, touch all those who are sick, and give everybody double portion of your spirit that we may seek a closer walk with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
indeed is among us. He is here. Secondly, he is real. Thirdly, he still speaks. And fourthly, out of the three, we must just reach out and touch him because he is just that much away from us. So I hope and pray that we'll carry those thoughts in our day-to-day lives. And for our visitors, like Sister Banchi said, please make this the beginning of your coming here. I know that today we were probably invited by somebody else, but after today, next Sabbath, feel free, be free to come and worship with us once again. Isn't it so, church?
Amen.
to ask you a question, but let me not only ask you a question just now. But have you asked these people to just greet us? Just ask these people to greet their name. They haven't done that.
Indeed, we have greeted you, so let's greet one another as well.
Thank you.
Matthew chapter 11. The book of Matthew chapter 11, and we read verse 28, 29. Matthew 11. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. I know that Jesus said a lot of things when he died, when he was dying on the cross. Among the things that really trouble me are the words he spoke, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. I mean, people are walking there and Jesus is hanging on the cross, and then they spoke words like, he saved others. And yet he can't save himself. Now, Jesus is God. Agreed? Ah, we don't have to agree. It's true. Jesus is God. Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you are being tempted within the powers that you have, but you don't use your power? Found yourself in a situation where you have a very small human being who threatens that they can beat you, and you can literally see that if you reacted, you will kill that guy. But then somehow you recoil within yourself and say, Father, forgive him, for he doesn't know what he's talking about. And Jesus says, come unto me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. I mean, even if Jesus is hanging on the cross up there, as those people are passing there and saying, he would have saved himself, but he's still hanging there. God, Jesus would have just said, fire from heaven. And they would have been consumed immediately. But I'm trying to look at the love of God and the mercy of God. And sometimes the things that you would expect God to react, but because of his mercy and his love towards each one of us, he would speak, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And when women come and they are crying and mourning and crying and sighing, and Jesus would say, don't mourn for me, mourn for yourselves. There are actually hard times. What you are crying for actually is a small matter. Cry for yourselves, because after these hard times are coming. Now, that's a person who is dying. Now, some of us, if an indication is given that we are dying, is just cursing and complaining, and people will be wondering whether you go to church or not. If you are asked to give the last words as you die, I don't know what you'd say. I don't know whether you'd forgive your enemies. But Jesus says, learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. Jesus, I know he is here. He is inviting us to join him in being meek. Not only meek by definition, but by character. It is this same Jesus who, after praying in the garden of Gethsemane, and these Roman soldiers come, and one of the disciples picks one of those pangas and chops off the ear, chwa, and it goes down. And Jesus says, this is not the way we fight in heaven. No, it's not about pangas. So Jesus lifted the ear and put it back on that young man. And I thought among the people that would be converted would be that guy whose ear was miraculously restored. And Jesus asked them, who do you seek? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. They fall down. Again, they stand up. If I were them, I said, no, I think this is not just a normal human being. Again, they ask. Jesus tells them, I am. Again, they fall down. Again, they stand. Again, he asks them, who do you want? No, we want Jesus. I say it, I am. Again, they fall down. Now, this is how far Jesus can go in being meek. in order. Now, these are the same people that Jesus wants to save. Actually, by doing that, he's communicating to them that what you're about to do is not even right. But because they are so determined, their minds are seared, they can't see anything there. And Jesus says, learn of me, for I am meek. I mean, I'm trying to imagine those people who are spitting on his face. Now you are spitting on the face of God, and God remains the same. I can imagine someone picking a whip. I'm just trying to imagine you are whipping God. Now, the God who opened that earth in the Old Testament, in the book of Numbers 16, and all the Korahites were swallowed up. But this time, you are weeping. And then he says, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing.
The Lord is my light.
a great honor to have visitors today. We've been looking forward to this day and we've been planning for it for quite some time. If I had a choice, I was going to call all the guests up front and just getting to know each one of them a little better. But I know time will not allow us. So I'll just invite one guest. I don't know, I hope he is still around. Brother Armstrong. Armstrong Habasune. I just want him to share a few words about today. Like, first of all, Armstrong, tell us a little bit about yourself, who you are, where you are coming from, and how you got to know the Lord.
Afternoon, Church.
Amen.
As you've heard, Armstrong Habasune, but at home they call me Tom. That's the name my grandmother knows. I'm from Shikata. I came in yesterday visiting my uncle. Unfortunately, I don't know the place where I'm staying. I just know the roots.
Can you tell us that you go like this?
You go on Kawe Road. Then there's a choir somewhere there.
Okay.
Yes, I'm not good at giving direction.
That's all right.
So you just go and call it. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I actually baptized, joined the church in 2002. Before that, I was a
okay. So, Brother Armstrong, I know you must have come for a different purpose from Stankata, but we are glad to have you here because it's a special day, especially dedicated to you. Just tell me some of the things that you have liked about today.
Number one is the music. I love music. Especially where you come from, this, where the music isn't as nice as it is here. We have so many groups, different people singing. You have a lot of people singing here in different groups, and actually, the music is better when the groups are bigger. The other thing is, you know, I just love visiting places. They say variety is the spice of life, so I also like spicing my Christianity by listening to different preachers, listening to different groups singing, visiting, meeting new people. So apart from the music, the same ones, all of them, I was in that room, but I enjoyed them.
Amen.
Then the people here, although others don't smell too much, but
okay, Armstrong, just one or two words for our guests who are not Adventists. What do you want them to carry away with them from this day?
Number one, they have to know that God loves them all. He does not choose whether you're short, tall, fat. Although these days they don't like saying fat, I know it's big, eh?
Big
and small. God loves you. I was not last year as well. I joined the church, as I said, in 2002. There was a crusade developed by Pastor John Bella. Pastor Yoda John Bella. And from that time, I've been ST. It's a lovely church. I think you enjoy being here. And actually, we, as a church, believe in keeping all the Ten Commandments. So you're invited. As you go back, we ask you to come back again and bring us.
You've heard it, our special visitors, non-Adventists and Adventists alike.
At this moment, I just want you to greet your neighbor and say, neighbor.
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 I'm talking to you, my neighbor. Oh, my neighbor.
Enjoy
this.
with the church your name and which church you are coming from, and how you are finding the program so far. Are you being blessed? Would you want to stay? Are you going to go?
Samuel Manakatwe. I'm from the UCZ, United Church of Zambia. And just to concur with Brother Tom, I'm really impressed to start with the music part. It's not a lie. Obviously, I'm from a church as well. But the music here is very different. It's at another level. For the sermon is powerful, and I'm not telling you what you want to hear. The music is awesome, people. It's nice.
Amen.
You know? I was telling my brother here that I was almost getting tempted. You know, we clap and we.
I want to go to that city. So
But I've always thought church was the best. And I still believe so. I tell people, and you know, one student was confessing this morning. He said, we thought that when you tell us you're a pastor, I always tell them that I'm a pastor at church. So don't disfellowship me, elders. I tell them I'm a pastor. She said, I thought you were telling us a lie in class that you're a pastor. No. So, and they saw a pastor. I thank God. So this one thing I do, and I, when I tell them this, I'm very sincere in class, that I love church. And I think they see that I love church so much. Mm. Not because I love the building, but I love the God that has seen me this far. Mm. You can love him too, and he can lead you through this life. Sometimes life would be empty, but never mind. He has placed a joy that you have never known right in your arms. Just embrace it, reach out. And one day soon, Sister Phyllis, you will appear as he tears the eastern skies.
Amen.
And we will see him and the trumpet shall sound. And all those dead in Christ shall rise again to meet him
in the air. Amen. For me, the most appropriate thing today was the theme, that he is here. And I'm sure all of us have sensed the presence of the Lord, because the Lord was here with us this afternoon. May we carry this light that we have shared today to the world, so that on that day when he comes back, many more will be caught up and we'll have our stars, our crowns shining with stars because of what we would have done from this day onwards. Amen, church.
Amen.
eyes are closed and we are praying. Father and my God, we are grateful to you. You have kept us safe from morning till now, and many messages have come our way. If we forget everything, may we remember that you are with each one of us individually. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, the guest day is only one of those special days that the Sabbath school has. Maybe I should just go through with you what the objectives of Sabbath school are. We have basically four main objectives. That is to study the Word of God. That is to encourage our members to study so that they may understand more about God. The second one is to promote fellowship amongst ourselves here as a church. The third one is the mission in the community, community outreach. And then the fourth one is to promote missions. As you know, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a world church. So we want every member to appreciate the fact that there are other members outside their own environment here that also need to be supported. Now, a community guest day is done in fulfilling the objective of community outreach. On this day, we encourage our members to invite the people that they live with in their communities to come and worship with them, share with them the Word of God, and also to fellowship with them. If you saw what happened today, we were overwhelmed. We had over 100 visitors who came to worship with us today, and I believe they have gone away with something, because we also used this as an opportunity to distribute literature. We gave them Seventh-day Adventist Belief so that they understand what this church is all about. We gave them the book, When God Said Remember, so that they again should understand the purpose of the Sabbath. We also gave them great hope that they too may look forward to the coming of Christ. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is a church that believes in the second coming of Christ. We are Adventists, meaning we are waiting for the advent of Christ. So we hope that through the literature that we have distributed and through the fellowship that we have had today, our guests who came will come back again.
This day is very important to personal ministries, because our mission is to reach out to the community around us and tell them about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And so using the vehicle of the guest day, we are able to invite especially non-Adventists in the community around us. And when they come to the guest day, as you saw today, we had so many non-Adventists, we are able to reach out to them through the sermons that are preached on the day, through the music, messages through music. But even beyond that, we use this day as a day when we can distribute literature to the non-Adventists that come to attend the day. So it really fits so well in our work as personal ministries.
This method has been quite effective, because what we largely do is when friends have come, like today, we will endeavor to capture their details and contact numbers. It basically is a starting point. We have one department, among others, which is called Interest Coordinator, and they will pick the details, and after a program like this, it will be up to that department now and the support of other church leaders to make a follow-up, to make follow-ups with these individuals, just to find out how their stay was today. And it becomes a starting point. Besides them learning what we are about, we also get important feedback from them. What is it that we are doing, which we are not doing, which they think we can do to make worship better, to make our God be praised more than he has done, than we have done in the past.
With care, it
its buds began to blossom, their sweet fragrance filled the air. But when winter came, weather, the petals drooped, fell to the ground. My heart sank as it faded, but I'd forgotten who had made it. And he said, roses will bloom again, just wait and see. Don't mourn what might have been. Heaven.